Good evening to all our participants here on Zoom, as well as our viewers on Facebook. Welcome to another exciting episode of True Talks for Coaches, a live masterclass for coaches and people who want to become coaches and help people transform their lives or achieve their goals. I am Mamta Sharma, Director, IHR Support Foundation, and a coach myself. At IHR, we are relentlessly working towards helping coaches and therapists build advanced coaching and therapeutic skills. To answer our questions, we have with us Nitin Shah, founder and director, IHR and IHR Support Foundation. Good evening and welcome, Nitin.
Good evening, Mamta. How are you?
I'm good. Before I go forward, I would like to share with everyone the workshops and initiatives that are underway at IHR right now. The Cognitive Hypnotic Coaching Certification course is being conducted online now, and you can check our website www.ichars.com for further details. In addition, you can also take up anxiety counseling and relationship counseling workshops for those of you who want to develop skills in these specific specializations. We also run a live support group for psychologists and therapists every Tuesday evening, and a peer coaching group every Sunday morning, where coaches can practice by coaching each other over an online platform. For a quick recap, as far as what we have talked about in this series so far, we've spoken about what coaching is, how coaching is different from seemingly related fields like training, mentoring, and so on. What coaching specializations are out there, what niches you can pick up, various coaching models. And now we are in a section where we are talking about coaching competencies that an effective coach would need to help their clients. And we have already spoken about establishing the coach-coachee relationship, following ethical guidelines, and effective communication skills. Please feel free to ask any questions or share any ideas in the chat boxes or comments, wherever you have any, and we'll take them up as we go. So Nitin, coming to the present episode, what are we talking about today? What is the next set of competencies?
So Mamta, the next set of competencies that we talk about would be facilitating learning and results. And this by itself is a broad categorization. So there are like multiple sub-competencies that we'll look at as we go ahead.
Okay. So can you explain what this is all about? Facilitating learning and results.
Okay. So before I explain this, tell me what comes to your mind when I talk about learning and results, especially in the context of coaching.
Okay. So the results that the client is looking for. Mm-hmm. So the coach should be able to help the client get there. Mm-hmm. And obviously, the client would need to, acquire some knowledge, undergo some learning in terms of where, for example, where they are, what all do they need to do, how to overcome any obstacles. So learning and results for the client.
Perfect. So would it be fair to say that the primary objective of any coaching session is to actually help the client learn and create a change, get results that they're looking for?
Correct. That would be fair. Yeah.
Right. And what would be the reasons that would stop people from learning or from creating a change? Apart from the clients not knowing what their end outcomes are. And obviously, with what we have discussed till now, we have spoken about how coaching is all about first helping the client identify where they want to reach.
Correct.
Where they are and creating a plan of action.
Right.
Now, what would stop the client from changing? Or getting results?
Okay. So that could be different things. Not having confidence that they would be able to actually execute that plan. Or things like fearing, what if something goes wrong? Not feeling motivated enough to, carry out the task as planned. Or for the duration that as planned. Not having the resources. So not having the right skills and so on.
Perfect. So wouldn't it be fair to say that a coach needs to have a competency to help the client work with each of these things?
Absolutely.
Right. So that is what this competency is about. The competency focuses not just on helping people understand things, but actually be able to move forward towards applying what they've learned and get the desired results that you're looking for.
Right. Okay. That sounds like, you know, the right thing. But you also spoke, you also said that, you know, this itself is a broad set. It's like a big set of sub-competencies. So what are those?
So one of the primary sub-competencies is raising awareness and insights.
Okay.
Now, what do you think awareness would be about in this sense, in this case?
Okay. So when it comes to coaching, I think awareness is the client needs to be aware of everything. Like as you said, where they are, where they need to be, what options do they have, what tasks do they need to do, what is stopping them, and so on. So I think awareness is like, you know, the fabric on which their entire process would be built.
Perfect. And isn't it true that we have been saying constantly mm-hmm. that a coach should not be suggesting things to the coachee or the client?
Correct.
So right. while the client or the coachee comes to a coach thinking that they don't have a solution,
mm-hmm.
they don't know how to go about things, or they don't know how to achieve their outcome,
mm-hmm.
the coach is actually not supposed to give an answer to the coachee. So how would a coachee resolve the problem or achieve the desired outcome? By having the coach ask them the right set of questions so that the coachee can then raise their awareness, get more insights about their own lives.
Mm-hmm.
So as I said, questioning is probably one of the key competencies that we have already discussed earlier.
Yes. Yeah.
But now we are not just talking about questioning, because questioning has its own limitations.
Right.
Right. Many a times clients will only be able to answer things based on what they are consciously aware of.
Right.
And to really help them brainstorm, or to really help them come up with ideas that are like insights that are coming from somewhere deep inside them, you need to be able to either ask questions and go into immense details,
mm-hmm.
or you need processes to be able to help the client connect with themselves so that they can get deeper insights.
Right.
In some coaching cases, the client just stumbles upon those insights.
Mm-hmm.
But would we like to leave things to chance when it comes to coaches?
No, not at all.
Wouldn't it be better for us to have certain skills,
mm-hmm.
certain processes, certain techniques
mm-hmm.
that can help the client
mm-hmm.
get into that state
right.
where they can get their insights?
Absolutely.
Right?
That would be ideal.
Can you say that again, please? Sorry.
I said that would be ideal.
That would be ideal, right? And the moment the client or the coachee gets into that state where they can get insights, they will be able to come up with their own answers.
Correct.
Right? Now Correct. Think and tell me, what is the biggest advantage of this? Why do we want the clients to come up with their own answers?
Because if it's their own answers, then there's a high likelihood that the client will accept them. So the resistance would be minimal. You know, a lot of times coaches and even therapists talk about the client resistant to change. But if the answers are their own and I'm not the one suggesting, then the resistance would be least.
Perfect. And that's one of the key reasons why helping people raise awareness in a way in which the insights come from them is right. an extremely useful idea, because they don't question you. They don't conflict you. It's their idea. It's no longer your idea.
Okay.
Right. And people generally feel it's easier for them to follow their own ideas as compared to someone else's.
Yeah, of course. Yes.
Right. And this is the key reason why we use hypnosis as a part of the coaching process. And I've been asked this question by a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
But why use hypnosis? For this reason, because mm-hmm. if you can use hypnosis, you can help the client connect with that part of them,
mm-hmm.
which will help them get their answers.
Right.
That saves me a lot of work as a coach, doesn't it?
Absolutely. So it's like win-win on both sides. Yeah.
Correct.
So how do you do that? So how do you create that state in which they are able to come upon their own insights, their own solutions?
So there are multiple ways of doing it. But one of the things that I use personally is certain metaphors in a mm-hmm. hypnotic state,
mm-hmm.
which help the client explore ideas in their mind
right.
in an abstract manner,
mm-hmm.
And because they are not really thinking of ideas literally. So many times what you will notice is when you ask clients to come up with ideas or brainstorm ideas literally, they start getting blocked by being within the dynamics of their own beliefs.
And because they are not really thinking of ideas literally. So many times what you will notice is when you ask clients...
Mamta, is your video on? Because I'm hearing my own voice in the background.
No. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Perfect. So I was saying that, what was I saying? That the client can actually, with the help of metaphors, the client can break through what their existing beliefs are, because they are no longer looking at things literally.
Okay.
Right. And that is what can really help them brainstorm and explore ideas. One of the processes that we use is called revelation metaphor.
Okay.
Now, what is a revelation metaphor is, as the name suggests, you're using a metaphor to help the client reveal something.
Something, yeah.
Right? So the way I would use that is I would guide the client in a hypnotic state first. And then I'll ask them to imagine themselves in a garden.
Okay.
And I'll ask them to explore the garden.
Okay.
And then you know how we have treasure hunt?
Yeah.
So the client will do a treasure hunt in their mind using that metaphor, where they will be told that as they're in that garden and as they explore the garden, they will begin to notice certain clues. Clues which they have to be able to explore, understand, and those clues will guide them to the next set of clues.
Okay.
And this will continue till they will reach a place where the last clue will take them to this huge tree.
Okay.
Then I'll give a description of the tree, whatever description I would like to give. So basically, it's to tell the client that this is where the treasure is.
Okay.
Okay. And then eventually, once you reach that tree, behind that tree, you will notice this huge stone.
Okay.
And below that stone, you will find a piece of paper that will contain a message for you.
Okay.
A message that will help you understand. Now, whatever I want the client to understand, for example, if the client says that I don't know what my purpose is, then a message that will help you understand what is your purpose.
Right.
A client says that, you know, I have an idea. So I have a purpose, but I'm not able to find the first step to begin. So the message will help you understand what that first step should be.
Right. Perfect.
So what? So whatever it is where the client feels stuck, that they don't know what to do next, I can convert that into a revelation metaphor, help the client explore that metaphor, and at the end of that treasure hunt, they find that message that gives them an insight into what they can do next. It's their solution that comes from their mind.
Absolutely. That sounds fantastic and very useful, I'm sure. And I hope... everyone who's listening, watching, has understood and can use. Can anyone use it with their clients, Nitin?
Yeah, you can actually use this with any client. Any place where a client is not having insights and wants to get insights.
Okay.
Yeah. This is a brilliant process to use.
Okay.
There is an extension of this process that I at times use. So there are places where a client would look for an insight. And there are places where a client wants to know, how can I apply this insight in my life?
Correct.
Right. So for application of the insight, there is a metaphor that we use, which is called introspection metaphor.
Okay.
So the idea of introspection metaphor is that you begin with a revelation. Once you've got a revelation, then you introspect on that idea to understand how that idea can be applied in different areas of their life.
Right.
So taking forward the garden itself.
Yeah.
I would actually tell them that, all right, now that you found that insight, right? Look around and you'll be able to notice the different flowers, the different fruits. Just describe what you can see in the garden.
Okay.
Let them describe that. And I'll tell them, as you begin to describe these different things that you can notice in the garden, your mind will begin to explore how this message can be applied to different areas of your life. Given that everything that you're exploring in the garden represents a specific area of your life. So garden, so the flowers represent something, the trees represent something, and whatever the client tells me, I will tell the client each of these items represent an area of your life. And as you explore these items, as you explore these things, you will begin to understand how this insight can be applied in these different areas. I have worked with clients where I have helped them create a complete plan of action based on this. So they set their goal based on the revelation metaphor, and then they created a complete plan of action based on the introspection metaphor.
That's really interesting. And you know, at some level, I was like doing it in my head when you were saying it for myself. So I think I've got a glimpse of how useful this can be. And it's a simple tool, but I'm sure it's extremely, extremely effective, you know, when it comes to helping. So when we are told that help the client find their own answers or create an environment where they can find their own answers, it's not easy to understand what is being said, but what you just demonstrated, or you know, you were explaining, for me it became a demonstration. So I think that's like, if I can say, really cool.
So that's actually one of the things. As I said, in classical coaching, one of the key challenges that we face is that we understand what coaching is, we understand what needs to be done, but the toolkit is still very limited.
Right.
And this is where the additional topics, the additional fields that you're talking about come in.
Right. Perfect. Makes sense. So that was, how to raise awareness or how to help the client get their insights, right? What next?
So before we go ahead, if any of you have any questions about the technique that I've just shared, or any other questions regarding the competencies we're talking about, please feel free to ask them in the comments, because then it will be easier for us to also answer all of those questions. And this is to both people who are on Zoom with us and people who are on Facebook with us.
Yeah, right. Perfect.
Sorry, so Mamta, what is the next question that you asked me?
I said, what's the next sub competency?
So once you have raised awareness.
Okay.
Right. It's important to also understand that the awareness needs to be accepted by the client.
Correct. Yeah. Oh, yes. That's right? Important.
And that's the reason why you also need to be able to invite possibilities. Many a times clients would sit in front of you, talk to you, and they would tell you that, it's not even possible for me to achieve this outcome.
Right.
And as I said earlier, many a times those resistances are coming from the client's existing beliefs, which are limiting them.
Correct. True.
So we need to be able to help them look outside the purview of those beliefs to actually be able to see their lives, not within the limitations of those beliefs, but by actually stepping outside.
Okay.
And that's when inviting possibilities come in.
Okay.
Again, for me, inviting possibilities and increasing awareness will go hand in hand.
All right.
Okay. The same processes that we are using for inviting awareness, increasing awareness, can also be used for inviting possibilities.
Okay. Nitin, this reminds me of the case we were discussing, a few weeks ago, where, remember I spoke to you about like a lot of people feeling confused or stuck between, should I choose this or this, or my parents are telling me to do this, but I want to do this. You know, there are a lot of clients, especially young graduates and, young professionals in that dilemma. And how, we spoke about why not choose both. I mean, so there's the possibility that you can do two things. You don't have to look at them as one or the other, which are two possibilities. There's a third one, which is both, right?
So which is actually brilliant, because that's one of the things that happens with clients, that many a times they're just looking at these specific options they have, and they're not able to explore additional options that may be available. And the challenge that we have is we can't say to them.
Correct.
So you need something to be able to work with them, right? Absolutely. Now, To give you an answer, so for example, to give you an example of how I would work with this, there's again a process that I do, which is like a combination of hypnosis and metaphor. Well, I'll ask the client, what is the outcome that they're looking for?
Correct.
And what are the existing options that they have?
Okay.
Right. I would take them down to a garden, from a garden to a pathway. And on that pathway, I would tell them, you are at a crossroads where there are as many roads going ahead as are the number of options you have.
Okay.
Right. Now, interestingly, what I've noticed is, let's say the client began by telling me that, Nitin, I have three options. Generally, they don't see three roads. They end up seeing four or five roads.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Which is their mind telling them, wait, there are more possibilities available. Right. Now, there are also places where clients will tell you options, but they would say that, I don't think this will be possible.
Right.
I would tell them, when you're going through the process, put all the options in front of you, even the ones that you think will not be possible.
Okay.
Now what happens is, we ask them to explore each of those options.
Okay.
And as they explore each of those options, by the time they, again, it's metaphorically, so they, I would actually tell them that each road will take them to a mountain. As they reach the mountain, they'll be able to describe how the mountain looks, how they feel in the mountain, what they can see beyond the mountain. Right. And they will also be able to notice what is the journey been like. Now, what happens is, metaphorically, again, they're able to understand how each of the options will play out, how difficult taking that option would be, how what kind of a future they can expect metaphorically when they use a particular option. And then people at the end are able to make a choice, saying, all right, what option do I want? Which future would it help us achieve?
Okay.
I've had clients, for example, who have at times told me that, Nitin, I went through the options. There was one option that was really smooth. But, you know, the future was okay. Well, I was happy, but it was not like an aha future. And then there was one option where the route was difficult. So I really had to be careful. There were places where there were narrow lanes and I had to ensure that I don't slip and so on. But when I reached the mountain, oh, it's impossible to describe how beautiful that was.
Right.
Right. So I asked the client, which one would you want to choose? Because now we also had to identify what steps they would have to take, what plan of action they would create, and what options they want to pick up. Right. And the client told me that, I would have never picked up the second option. But now that I've seen that mountain and I've seen how beautiful it looks, I don't think I can choose anything else but that option.
Right. And what you did earlier, the revelation bit can help them understand what being careful represents. So if they were being careful, so that can turn into a concrete action in the conscious sense, right?
Yes, perfect. In fact, so obviously after this, once the client is able to invite possibilities, are able to raise awareness metaphorically, we would also work towards making the metaphor more literal. We would also help them identify exactly the steps that they need to take. But that's the next step.
Right. Makes sense. So Nitin, if I could just sum this up. So we would first use questioning models. We spoke about meta model to effectively question. And then hypnosis can create that state in which they can further develop insights and invite possibility and explore those options and what that actually means in their real life, right?
Correct. And then we can go back to questioning to be able to make the information a bit more detailed and literally help the client create an actionable plan of action, which is, by the way, one of the competencies that we'll talk about in a few moments.
Okay. That's wonderful. This is getting better by the question. Okay. All right. So raising awareness, inviting possibility. Now what?
Next one is ecological goal settings.
Okay.
Now, as we already know that goal setting is probably the primary base of the entire coaching process. Unless the client sets a goal, it's kind of very difficult to proceed from there.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Now, when we talk about goal setting in the competencies that we look at, for us, goal setting by itself is incomplete.
Okay.
A goal has to be ecological. Okay. And this is one of the primary things that a lot of goal setting and coaching processes miss, and why clients end up having what we call as relapses. Right? You would notice, let's say you're doing a coaching process where someone is working towards managing weight. You are a health coach and you are working towards helping people manage weight.
Perfect.
You've noticed how many people set the goals, create a plan of action, stick to the plan of action, and eventually have a relapse, so the weight comes back again.
Right.
Why?
Mm.
Or there are people who would tell you that I have been working towards my outcome. I've consistently been there till I was with my coach. Right? My coach continued supporting me, helping me, guiding me, and so on. And I was able to achieve my outcome. But over a period of time, there was again a relapse and I again had to go back to my coach for the same problem.
Hmm.
Or to achieve the same outcome. As in the outcome was not sustained.
Right.
Right? So one of the reasons why this happens is that we end up setting goals which are not ecological. This is actually a concept that comes from NLP. And a very, very useful concept.
Okay.
When I use the word ecological, what comes to mind? What do you mean by ecology? What do you think I mean by ecology?
So the first meaning that comes to me is from the way we use it in environment. Like everything is in a state of harmony, balance. Right. So that's the first thing that comes to my mind.
So that's actually a good way to put it. That things are in harmony and balance.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when we talk about ecological goal setting, what we are saying is that when you set a goal, your goal may be in one area.
Correct.
But you have to ensure that in no way does it influence any other area negatively.
Okay.
Let's take an example. Let's say someone says, I want to earn more money.
Yeah.
And in order to earn more money, I need to take up more work.
Correct.
Right. Now the goal overall looks fine, right? Earning more money. And it's logical that they have to take up more work.
Right.
That they will have to invest more time in their job or in their work or in their business.
Right.
Now let's say the same person also wants to improve their relationship with their partner.
Correct.
Making more money means more time at work, means less time with the partner.
Right.
Now, does this goal have a potential to negatively affect other areas of the client's life?
Definitely. Definitely.
And if relationship is...
It can also affect their health.
It can also affect their health. It can affect their social life. It can affect a lot of things.
Yeah, exactly.
But if one of these areas are really important for the client, let's take the example of relationship again.
Hmm.
Let's say that for the client or the coachee, the relationship is a very, very important area of their life.
Correct.
And if this goal has a potential to influence their relationship negatively,
mm-hmm.
would their mind support them in achieving this outcome?
No, and that's why I think a lot of people will give up after a while or feel that it's a struggle.
Or because they start working in this area and in this direction, when problems start in the area of relationship, it becomes very difficult to continue remaining focused over here.
Yeah.
So in some form or the other, if a goal is not ecological, which means it doesn't take care of all aspects of your life, then the chances that something will go wrong are very high.
Yeah.
Right. And that's the reason why both in NLP and in the way we work, there's a lot of emphasis that we put on ecological goal setting. So when the client is setting a goal, while they may set a smart goal and they may make it very specific, very measurable and all the other components of the smart goal, right?
Right.
But we would then ask them to look at how this goal impacts every other area of your life.
Correct.
And identify if there is any area that even has a remote chance of getting affected negatively by this goal. If there is, then the client has to identify what they can do to compensate for that side effect.
Okay. Wow.
So going back to the relationship example,
right?
So let's say the client sets that goal, starts creating a plan of action. And then when we do the ecology check, the client says it has a potential to influence my relationship negatively because I will not be able to spend as much time with my family as I would like to. My question to the client would be, all right. So when you're able to make more money or while you're working towards making more money, what can you do that will help you compensate for the side effect?
Right.
And the client thinks and then says, you know what? If I have more money, then, or when I'm working towards more money and I end up earning that extra amount, I can take my family out for a vacation. So while I will give 1 hour less every day to my family, I will compensate for that every month by taking them out for a two-day vacation. And I would completely be focused on them, which means I'll compensate for the hours.
Right.
And I would be able to spend quality time with them, which then has a potential to improve my relationship even more.
Perfect.
So as a part of the plan of action, the plan of action is not just to help them achieve their outcome. It's also to help them ensure that their outcome remains ecological.
Yeah.
And for that, understanding impact of goal on other areas of their life is extremely important.
Wow. Okay. That's interesting. So we have also taken care of any problems that may come up in the future.
Correct. So as a part of the coaching process, we are also taking care of potential problems that may come up. So, you know, I heard a lot of people saying that we need to have balance in our life. It's a very good concept to keep in mind.
Right.
But how do you actually create the balance? Do we ever really sit and think about the impact of one goal on other areas of our life? So it's okay to say that I want to have a balanced life where I'm able to spend X amount of time with my family, with my kids, I'm able to earn X amount of money and all of that. But if you want to work towards a particular outcome, you will have to take out time from somewhere and give time somewhere, right? You'll have to take out resources from somewhere and give those resources somewhere. Eventually, the resources and the time is still limited. There are only 24 hours in a day.
Yeah.
So unless we understand the impact of what we are doing on other areas of our life and plan for it so that those challenges can be minimized. The concept of balanced life is a concept more in theory than in reality. And a lot of people who teach living in a balanced life actually live it the hard way. You'll be surprised how many people who talk about balanced life, who talk about living a balanced life, actually end up having major concerns in their own lives.
Right, right. Nitin, there are so many organizations who, you know, can have trainings conducted on work-life balance. I guess if, you know, they could just understand this one thing, they don't need those long trainings on, you know. This itself is a big thing.
Correct. Right? So in fact, I would say that ideally, this should be a part of the training, that when they are doing their goal setting processes, this can be incorporated as a part of that process.
Right, right. Because, you know, I have been in such trainings and, you know, so people understand I should have me time. I should have time for my kid if I'm feeling guilty. I should have this and that. But nobody tells them the how, or probably they don't. The people who are training don't know the how to crack the how.
Which is when in the second challenge that comes is that while this sounds really good, that I need to spend X amount of time with my child, but my child has to go to school, I need to pay the school fees.
Correct. Absolutely. Absolutely.
So then that's where people get stuck. They're all right. So I need more money. I understand I need to create a balance. But
how?
Once I have money, I'll see. And the problem with that approach, that once I have money, I'll see, is that you will always keep running. So the moment you put it in your head, they're all right. Once, while I'm working towards money, I'm going to give this much time every month to my family in this format. Right? It makes the entire thing a lot more streamlined and a lot more structured.
Right.
And it's easier to follow, actually.
Perfect. That makes a lot of sense. I'm sure everyone who's watching it does to them as well. Okay, that's really interesting. Ecological goal setting. What next?
I hope the idea of ecological goal setting is clear, because as I said, this is very important and something that not many people really pay attention to. Actually, most of us don't even know about it. Until I did not do NLP, I did not even know the idea of ecological goal setting.
Exactly, exactly. And I think this sounds like really, really important, because a lot of people may have, if not a very clear idea, some idea of goal setting, short-term goals, long-term goals. But this, I think, puts a lot of things in perspective. So, yeah, that's a great learning point. All right. So, are there other sub-competencies to learning and results?
So, once we help people set ecological goals, obviously, the next step is to help them design their plan of action.
Yeah, of course.
Right? And remember, that's what I said, that when we are doing awareness raising, when we are doing inviting possibilities, we are kind of helping the client explore more and more options.
Right.
But eventually it needs to be put down on paper where you can really streamline everything that the client needs to do.
Okay.
Right. And it needs to be streamlined in a way in which they should at any point of time, they should know what the next step should be. They shouldn't need to think. The paper should tell them, all right, this is the next thing that I need to do.
All right. Okay. But isn't all goal setting like that? It isn't.
No, it isn't. There are so many times when we set goals, we create a plan of action, but our plan of action are not really precise. Our plan of actions can be a bit abstract.
Okay. I remember hearing you saying that, you know, even a young child, even a 6-year-old should be able to look at that plan of action and be able to carry it out.
Yeah, so that's our general guideline when we talk about helping people create the plan of action. Okay. That the plan of action needs to be so clearly specified that even a 6-year-old child should be able to look at that and know, all right, this is the next step that I need to take. And the child should feel I should be able to do this.
All right.
So one really needs to chunk it down.
Okay. Nitin, can we quickly take an example of how we can, like, what's a vague goal and what's a specific goal and how do you chunk it down, as you said?
Okay. Manta, tell me one thing that you want to do, one major thing that you want, that you think is stopping you from achieving your outcomes, that you would need to do to achieve your outcomes. What would that be?
My outcomes? So being able to market and promote myself better.
Perfect. So market and promote myself better sounds like a plan.
It is.
All right. But what do you really mean by market and promote?
Okay. What do I really mean? So a couple of things. I should have a website that ranks well. I should my social media presence should be wider. Reach should be wider. Right. What else? Visibility, being seen on platforms other than my own. So all that.
Now, if I were to tell you, Mamta, tomorrow morning, you need to start marketing and promoting yourself. When you sit in front of the laptop, do you really know what needs to be done to promote and market yourself?
Not really. And that's what's been a challenge.
Right. Now, if you don't know what needs to be done, so while you know that your plan is to market and promote, but if you don't know how to do it, you will not be able to, right? Because then the moment you sit and you start thinking, something else pops up on Facebook or on another social media channel and your mind automatically goes over there.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm looking at, let's say, as you said, Facebook. Okay, let me look at what other people are doing. And then I don't know where, like an hour, 2 hours, they just pass by, drift.
Correct. So what really happens is the idea that I need to promote and market myself is not a very clear idea. So while I'm trying to think about it, I see a video and I think the video dekh lete. Now that's a very clear, simple step that you need to take.
Right.
The moment that video ends, right, in the comments somewhere, someone would have shared a link or someone would have shared a link in the video itself. And you will say, "Acha, chal ek baar click karke dekh leti." Because click karna is again a very small step that you can understand.
True.
But marketing is not. Right. Now, while you mentioned that I need my website to rank well, how?
So I think I need to do SEO because I can't do it on my own. I would like to hire an agency. But then again, I don't know which one is a good one and not just a money-making business. I need somebody who knows their thing and will obviously charge a reasonable price for their services. So hunting for that.
Perfect. So be able to find the right person for your SEO work.
Correct.
So would it be fair to say that your broad plan is marketing? Step in that is setting a having a website which ranks well. Next step in that is, or a sub step in that is, to be able to find the right SEO guy. Now, how would you find the right SEO guy?
Okay, so I've told some friends if they know somebody. I looked up online, but then obviously everybody says good things about themselves. So you don't know which one to pick. So probably I need to speak to somebody who has done this for themselves and have been already. So look for a referral.
Okay. And can you think of a couple of people around you who may have done something like this earlier, who will be able to refer people that they worked with, that they can vouch for?
I can think of two right now.
Two right now.
Mm-hmm.
So would connecting with them be one of the steps that you need to take?
Yeah.
When would you connect with them?
Now that you just asked me this question, tomorrow morning. Or I can drop a message tonight and say that I would like to speak to you tomorrow morning.
And what time?
So after we are done with this episode, I'll send them a WhatsApp.
Perfect. So can you put an alarm in your phone for 8:30 saying that send a message to my friend asking them to connect
like
with them
right
tomorrow?
Now?
Right now.
Okay. All right. I will.
So do you see what we have done? We actually began with a broad plan of action. Right. But I actually brought you down to the most obvious step that you can do, which is the first step.
Okay.
And now this putting an alarm in the phone can actually be done by a 6-year-old child also.
Yeah. This is, you know, there's a phrase in a story, which it's, this is becoming interestinger and interestinger. So this is this has become so much more interesting. Okay.
Brilliant. Perfect. Oh, and good. So you've set the alarm, right?
Yeah.
Cool. So that's basically the idea that when you're creating a plan of action, it's not just about creating a plan of action. It's also about being able to chunk the plan of action down so much so that at every step, the mind doesn't have to think what needs to be done. You're already prepared for at least 3 steps in advance.
Perfect.
You know, have you ever heard this? While I'm saying this now, I'm realizing it. There are so many times that in movies or even in conversations, I've heard people saying that guy is always 3 steps ahead of us.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Right. And that's what we're talking about, that we need to be 3 steps ahead of what we need to do next.
Right.
Obviously, I'm not saying that you should know the plan completely, because it may be at times impossible to know the entire plan.
Yeah, of course.
But whatever steps you know, in those steps, at least the first 3 small steps that you need to take.
Yeah. So, for example, right now, I don't know who are these guys and what will they tell me to do? How much do I have to pay and so on? But at least the very next step is like crystal clear. And it also, one, there's a great sense of relief. And, you know, there's a sense of motivation also. So it's, you're not feeling lost anymore. So several things happened quickly.
Perfect. Brilliant. And that's what we mean by helping people design their plan of action. And that's a competency. And again, for this, questioning skills are extremely, extremely important.
Oh, yes. You did ask me a series of seemingly simple, but I'm sure really effective because, wow. Okay. That's
right. And
I'm taking time for that to sink in. Okay.
So in order to do this, 2 things that we actually use extensively in our processes is the meta model from NLP and the soft C model for coaching.
Okay.
In fact, everything that we are talking about is actually the soft C model, is part of the soft C model. But meta models would be the specific set of questions that we will ask within the framework of soft C.
Okay. All right. That's really, really interesting. Okay, so now I'm really excited to know what next.
So the next is helping people overcome conscious and unconscious hindrances.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what this means is that once we create a plan of action, the client still needs to take action, right?
Correct.
So tell me, what can stop the client from taking action?
Okay. Now, because you've got me thinking in my own terms, so I may say I don't have the money to pay the agency, or if let's say I want to start an office tomorrow, I don't have the space. As I said earlier, people may have a lack of confidence, a lack of motivation. Let's say a part of, as when I was saying marketing, let's say one of the things that I need to do is make videos, and I may not know how to, if make, then how to edit videos, what apps to use. People use all kind of apps and effects and putting text and tickers and all. So how to do that? So if I was to categorize this, probably resources, skills, and the mental abilities like patience, motivation, confidence, and so on.
So would it be fair to say that we can broadly divide these into lack of resources,
correct,
lack of skills, and mental state?
Yeah.
Right? Yes. Now, resources and skills will eventually take us back to more tasks.
Hmm.
More steps in the plan of action, because I can always work towards developing more resources. Correct. I can always develop skills.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
What eventually stops me
is
my mental state.
Yes.
Right? So, for example, you spoke about recording a video.
Correct.
So, you may have the mobile phone with which you can record the video.
Correct.
You have the skill to record a video. You've recorded a lot of selfie videos to put on Facebook earlier.
Correct.
Right? But now that you're recording a video for work, the thought of recording a video may make you think, or the idea of recording a video may make you think, what if people don't like me? What if they don't like my work?
Correct.
What if even the ones who are coming to me stop coming to me? Right?
Yeah.
Now, would you be able to create that video?
No, not at all. Not at all.
Okay. Or if you were to feel very anxious, very scared about doing something, then would you be able to do those things?
No.
So wouldn't it be fair to say that eventually, the while at an observable level, our work is to help people change behaviorally.
Correct.
But for a behavior to change sustainably, in a way in which the client can sustain it, does not have a relapse, right? You have to help them change their thoughts and emotions as well.
Right.
And the problem with thoughts is many times thoughts are unconscious. Clients will tell you, I don't know what happened. I look at a camera and I go blank.
Right.
Yes. Right?
Yes.
So if their thoughts, their emotions at times are unconscious, or at least they're not aware of the source of the thoughts or the emotions, then how do you help them change that?
Right.
And that's a very, very important competency, not from a classical coaching point of view. Most classical coaches are not aware of this. They would use the next coaching competency that we'll talk about, which is about helping people become more accountable so that they will force themselves to take action. Right? Or they would have to persist and use this strong willpower to do things. But that creates a lot of internal conflicts. And I, for one, am not in favor of people having a conflict with themselves. Because it's a conflict, no matter who wins, you lose.
You're fighting with yourself. Yeah.
You're fighting with yourself. Right? And hence, I would rather work with people in a way in which they're able to also change their thoughts, their emotions, even if they're unconscious.
Okay.
In fact, a lot of times now, a lot of coaching institutes at least talk about beliefs, talk about values, and they try to tell coaches that you also need to be able to work with clients' beliefs and values.
Right. Okay. Right.
But again, the tool that they have is only questioning. And eventually questioning can only take you till a level, till a place. Because beyond a point, when you question too much, the client also gets irritated. That when is this questioning going to end?
Correct.
Right? And also the right set of questions to really understand what's happening in the unconscious is not what people learn.
Okay.
And that's what we heavily emphasize on.
Oh.
That's for us the difference between being a decent coach and becoming a great coach.
Right.
Right. And to that extent, for us, that's a very, very important competency to take care of.
Right. Right. Okay. And we do that with the help of hypnosis, right?
So there are a lot of processes. We use processes from hypnosis, from NLP, from metaphors. Technically, for me personally, NLP techniques, metaphors are applied hypnosis. So to that extent, we're using hypnosis everywhere. Right. But yeah, if you were to ask me, there are specific techniques that are covered in an NLP program, or there are specific techniques that would probably also be covered in a metaphor program that we incorporate into our work. But yeah, obviously, if you've done a cognitive hypnotic coaching course, or if you're planning to do that course with us, then that's already all covered in the program.
Okay. Whatever we just spoke about and in the previous episodes, right?
Everything that we spoke about, everything that we'll speak about, and a lot more.
Okay. 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 Perfect. Perfect. So, Nitin, we spoke about identifying what is unconscious and addressing it, right? So that the client can actually carry out the plan of action and reach their outcome. So, because you're saying we can work with thoughts, emotions, beliefs, and all that, is there something that coaches, cognitive hypnotic coaches cannot help the client do?
A cognitive hypnotic coach will still not be able to work with clients' intense negative emotions or disorder, because obviously that's not what we are training them for. That doesn't fall within the definition of coaching.
Yeah. So that
except for that, that's therapy. So except for that, they should be able to do everything else. Now, if you are a coach who also wants to become a therapist,
okay,
right? Then obviously we have advanced levels, but for that you will also have to enroll for a master's program in psychology, because we have kind of made it as a mandatory requirement for the therapy program.
Okay. Perfect. That's interesting. Right. And are there any more sub-competencies?
There is one last sub-competency, which is accountability.
Okay. Right.
Right. So basically what it is called is managing progress and accountability.
Okay.
Now, when I say accountability, what does the word mean for you?
The coach holds the coachee accountable to follow the plan of action and the tasks that they have discussed in the sessions.
Perfect. So once the coach has asked the right set of questions, use the processes to help the coachee create the plan of action.
Right.
There are things that the coachee still has to do. Right. Yes. So for example, to be able to manage the thoughts and emotions, while we may use certain processes, we may teach them certain clients, they still may need to practice those techniques with themselves.
Of course.
They also obviously have to take the specific steps that they have mentioned.
Yes.
Right. In your case, at 8:30 or after 8:30, once we have completed this discussion, you still have to send that message to your friends and tomorrow call them up and speak to them.
Yeah.
Right. Now, as a coach, I have to ensure that I am making you accountable for whatever actions you have mentioned.
Correct.
Okay. And for that, what I would do is I would ask you to break your plan of action into smaller chunks, as I discussed earlier. But during the week, I'll ask you to pick 3 or 4 tasks that you will commit for.
Okay.
Okay. Then we will apply the processes to help you overcome your unconscious hindrances, conscious hindrances. So that those 4 things, you find those 4 things as the natural 4 things to do.
Right.
And then at the end, so in the next week, when we begin a session, I will then take a review of feedback in terms of whether you have been able to do those tasks.
Mm-hmm.
If yes, brilliant. If no, then again, we go back to identifying what those conscious and unconscious hindrances were that stopped you, help you overcome that, so that in the next week, you will be able to apply those tasks. And on a weekly basis, and we'll keep track of your progress. Any place where you're not able to do certain things, accountability would come in so that I can keep track of it. I can ask you what stopped you and help you work on it. So this is accountability and managing progress.
Perfect. Okay. That's about facilitating learning and results, right?
Correct. So all of these competencies together, basically, is what we are doing with the clients. So those are the competencies that we have that we are utilizing to help the clients achieve their outcome.
Perfect.
And that's your entire coaching process.
Okay. That's really interesting, very useful. And yes, when we work with clients, we do come across these challenges as coaches, as change makers. So yes, very, very relevant and very useful. All those people who are with us right now on Zoom or on Facebook, please feel free to ask any questions that you have about what we have discussed today or in the previous episodes, so that we can help you understand more, help you answer those questions. So that will be interesting to have any questions, comments. There are some comments on Zoom. Zenith is saying that yes, she understands that it happens when they're working with clients. It's interesting. Yes, Zenith, it is. Okay. Perfect.
And there are some comments on Facebook as well. So I'm just, some of you have joined us very late. So
yeah.
Still, thank you very much for joining us today. And I hope even if you've not been able to catch the entire video, you will be able to catch it after we complete the session.
Right. Perfect. So what is
any other questions, any other things that you have in your mind that you would like to ask me? Because we are done with the competencies now.
Right. And so what is our next episode about? That's what I'm interested in.
Our next episode will be about the different. So we spoke about the coaching models, right? In the last episode.
Right.
We would, in all possibilities, explore the soft C model more.
Okay.
Which will be one.
Yes.
And then we will talk about the different, how different professionals can benefit from coaching. As in, who are the people who should visit a coach?
Right.
And how they can benefit by visiting a coach.
Perfect. That's really interesting. Nitin, Pooja is asking, how much time will this process take with the client? I mean to say days.
So Pooja, that actually depends upon what the client wants to achieve and what the client wants to work with. If the client is looking at working with specific outcomes,
okay,
right? And when I say specific outcomes, it's like more behavioral outcomes. Then probably at times one or two sessions also are enough. And then there are places where clients would want to work towards greater goals, and those goals may take longer period of time. But on an average, when we work a complete coaching process will take around 8 sessions. So that's what we ask the client for, that please plan for 8 sessions. Generally, by the time we reach the 6th session, the clients are already more or less on track to be able to achieve their outcome. But then we ask for 8 sessions, because when you tell clients 8 sessions and they're able to achieve their outcomes in 6 sessions, they feel happy. But if you say 6 sessions, and if you take 7 sessions, then they kind of feel a bit uncomfortable. So it's always better to undercommit and then over deliver.
Perfect. So Nitin, we can safely say a session a week, because she's asking for days. So they would on an average week. Yeah.
So for coaching, it's 1 session a week, because between each session, I also want the client to be able to do those tasks so that I can monitor and I can observe whether the client is able to do it or not. And if they get stuck somewhere, then where are they getting stuck?
Correct. Right. So Pooja, I hope you have your answer. Pooja was not able to get the voice. So, okay. So
Pooja, let us know if you've got the answer in another comment. If you still feel that you have not, then I'll repeat it.
Yeah. Okay. Shilpa finds it interesting. Thank you, Shilpa. Okay. People on the Zoom group, if you have any questions, feel free to ask. Okay.
Also, the videos will be available on the IHR's Facebook page tomorrow. We will also upload this on the YouTube channel. So you have options to be able to check this out at any of the places.
And in both the places, I must share this with everyone. There is, for lack of any other word, tons of useful content, especially for practitioners, coaches, therapists. So do, you know, keep visiting. We keep updating it, especially the YouTube channel. We keep posting all the content there. Another very interesting bit that I would like to share here is that at IHRS, we are running the Visit Mental Health Practitioner Challenge. For those of you who are mental health practitioners, especially, I'll come to those who are not, you know, you can pledge your support to the challenge. So the challenge is about the fact that usually mental health and going seeking help with a mental health practitioner is taken as something you do when you are, you know, in the grip of a disorder or you've hit rock bottom, as I say it. Whereas, you know, mental health is like any other health. You have to be proactive about it. It begins much earlier. So the moment you start feeling that, you know, you're having a mental emotional challenge, you're feeling overwhelmed, disturbed, stressed, anxious for a couple of days and you're not able to resolve it, it's time to seek a mental health professional's help. So that's the whole idea. We're just trying to help people understand and also overcome the stigma around the notion, because generally it's only when, you know, a major incident like a celebrity committing suicide happens that we, you know, attention is brought to mental health. So you can go and pledge support. Even people who are not from the mental health background, coaches or the practitioners, individuals from various walks of life, you can go and pledge support. We are all doing it. There is a lot of interesting content in terms of images and all that there. You can go share it on your social media accounts. You can, you know, that will be your bit to the cause. And it only takes a moment. The website, we have shared the website links. It is visitmhp.com. So I think, and a lot of people are joining the cause. So that's heartening to see so many people coming forward and, you know, recognizing the fact that we need to talk about this. Okay. All right. So I have, Shiv Kumar is asking, are we supposed to do assignments?
The clients are supposed to do the assignments, right, where the assignments basically becomes the tasks that they need to do. So each task during the week, you can call them as assignments. Okay. Perfect. So to give you an example, for example, when Mamta said right now during the session that at 8:30 or 8:40, I would call up or send message to my friends. Mm-hmm. And then tomorrow I'll call them up. For her, both of these will become assignments. These are like a part of the plan that she needs to complete during the week that she's committing to.
Yeah. By the way, my alarm has already rung, so I need to do it the moment we are through with this episode. Okay, no. which is so interesting. All right. So, you know, it's interesting also because a lot of times and a lot of people keep talking about how to stay motivated, how to, you know, where to get the intrinsic motivation from. So I think this is a wonderful way to do that, ensure that that happens and you do the task, the client does the task. Okay, I think Nitin, that brings us to the end of this episode.
Perfect. So thank you everyone for joining us. If you have any questions, if you've joined us late, please feel free to comment in the comments. And I would, in the next session before we begin, take up those questions and answer those questions. Also, you can always join the WhatsApp group. Those of you who are already a part of the WhatsApp group, please ask us any questions that you have in the group. We will answer those questions in the group itself. Right? And I hope to see all of you next week.
If anyone wants to know about the cognitive hypnotic coaching course, which helps you train in all these competencies and whatever we are talking about, you can visit www.ichars.com. Very interestingly and fortunately, the courses are now available online. They're being conducted online because of the pandemic. So you can do it wherever you are. You can choose weekend batches. You can choose weekday batches. and you are good to go.
Perfect. And lastly, tomorrow there is the psych talks with teachers. So if you are a psychology student who is looking at understanding more about how to go about understanding certain subjects in psychology, and if you have specific questions that you want to ask some really amazing teachers, please join us tomorrow at 7:30. Misbah would be there as a host for that particular session.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. See you all next week.
Good night.
Take care. Good night.